The date is August 1945, and deep in the United States' top-secret nuclear laboratory at Los Alamos, a 14-pound sphere of plutonium sits inside a lab, awaiting its insertion into the world's third wartime nuclear bomb. Yet it will no longer be needed, as after suffering dual atomic bombings and now facing an invasion fleet of 1 million Soviet soldiers, Japan has at last surrendered, bringing the Second World War to an end. Over 200,000 Japanese had died already to the two nuclear attacks at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and many more would die in the months and years to come from the deadly radiation. The 14-pound sphere of plutonium was meant to be the heart of the third atomic bomb, but is no longer needed. Yet the beating heart of an atom bomb would still claim more human lives before being disassembled. Plutonium was first discovered on December 14, 1940 by a team of American researchers at the University of California in Berkeley. The new element had been produced during deuteron bombardment of a uranium target. The uranium sample began to rapidly emit electrons, which produced a new element, whose own nucleus would then emit a single electron and become element 94, plutonium. Originally, the researchers planned on submitting a research paper to the scientific journal Physical Review in March of 1941. But when it was discovered that a special isotope of the new element, plutonium-239, could undergo fission and be used in the construction of an atomic bomb, the paper was withdrawn and all research immediately fell under the umbrella of what would become the Manhattan Project. The US wasn't at war yet, but with researchers around the world racing to discover the atomic bomb, it could ill afford to fall behind or let other nations get wind of the discovery. Plutonium would prove to be essential for the building of the first atomic bombs, but production of usable plutonium was slow, very slow. It wasn't until construction of a revolutionary new type of plutonium production reactor in 1943 that the new element began to be produced in quantities suitable for the building of an atomic bomb. The door to a working nuclear weapon had at last been opened, and it would never be closed again. By summer of 1945, World War II was all but over, and it was thought that America would not need to deploy the newly developed and widely feared atomic bombs. Yet by August, it was clear that Japan would not surrender. Its Bushido culture viewing the unconditional surrender demanded by the Allies as an unbearable disgrace. They would rather go down fighting to a man, and with Japan's military leadership firmly in control of the civilian government, it seemed to all that a hugely bloody invasion of Japan would be needed in order to finally bring peace. For their part, the Soviets were already massing huge concentrations of troops, recently freed from the war in Europe, along their border with China as they prepared to strike into Japanese-held Manchuria, where over 1 million Japanese soldiers still waited. Once Manchuria was neutralized, they would then look east toward an invasion of Japan itself. The realization that Japan was between a rock and a hard place gave some pause to American leadership on the use of atomic bombs, but ultimately it was decided that the war needed to end as expediently as possible. So on August 6, 1945, Hiroshima went up in nuclear flames, the victim of the first atomic bombing in history. Initially, the Japanese government refused to believe the reports coming from Hiroshima. The total destruction of the city by a single bomb was unbelievable, and thus when warnings came from the US that they would deliver a second atomic bomb if Japan did not surrender immediately, they were largely ignored. 3 days later, Nagasaki joined Hiroshima in the ashes of history, and tens of thousands of people died in a flash of light. America immediately threatened the use of a third nuclear weapon, and shortly after, Japan sued for peace. Back home in the secret laboratory of Los Alamos, the 14-pound plutonium heart of what would have been the third wartime nuclear weapon sat in a lab, now unneeded for its original purpose. Codenamed Rufus, the spear would go from wartime use to peacetime nuclear research in a matter of days, as there was still plenty that scientists did not understand about nuclear weapons and the materials that made them up. Rufus, as it was known, would quickly earn a much more sinister nickname, that of the Demon Core. The first lethal accident caused by the core happened just 2 days after the cancellation of the Demon Core's bombing run, and less than a week after Japan's surrender. In Los Alamos, scientists were conducting experiments to measure the threshold at which plutonium would become supercritical. This was the point where a fissile material, such as plutonium in this case, accumulated in a small enough volume so that each fission event of the material would produce a neutron that would in turn strike another fissile atom, and cause another neutron to be created, which would then strike another fissile atom. This chain reaction is key to nuclear detonations, but without the very specific circumstances needed for an actual detonation, will instead result in the release of large amounts of radiation and extreme heating. These initial experiments to measure the criticality threshold of plutonium had a foreboding nickname, tickling the dragon's tail. This was because the physicists knew that if they were not careful and awakened the terrible beast from its slumber, they were going to be severely burned. On the night of August 21, 1945, physicist Harry Doglian would do just that, and in turn, the dragon would claim his life. That night, Doglian returned to his lab after dinner and began criticality experiments on the demon core alone, which was in clear breach of safety protocols. The only person with Doglian was a security guard seated a dozen feet away, but with no knowledge of physics himself, the guard's job was merely to ensure only authorized personnel entered the lab. As Doglian worked, he surrounded the demon core with bricks made of tungsten carbide. The core was constantly emitting neutrons, but with nothing to bounce them back, there was no risk of going supercritical. The bricks of tungsten carbide, however, acted as a mirror of sorts, bouncing the shed neutrons back at the core, which would cause the reflected neutrons to knock other neutrons loose from the fissile plutonium. Each brick added around the sphere would slowly edge the entire material closer to a supercritical reaction. With the reflective bricks built up around the core, his equipment warned him that if he added any more bricks to the wall surrounding the demon core, it would go supercritical. Thus, Doglian began to remove one of the bricks away. The sleeping dragon had been prodded, and though briefly roused, it still slumbered. As he moved the brick away, though, he accidentally dropped the brick on top of the plutonium sphere, and in doing so, immediately induced supercriticality. A flash of blue light and a wave of heat bathed the laboratory, and Doglian immediately snatched the brick away, stopping the chain reaction. Unfortunately, it was too late. The dragon had woken, and in the brief second it had been roused from its slumber, it had already delivered a lethal dose of radiation to Doglian. His hand, which initially felt tingly and numb, quickly became severely burned and then swelled up and blistered over. After weeks of severe pain and nausea, Doglian was dead, and the demon core had achieved its first kill. A year later, physicist Lewis Slotin was demonstrating a similar criticality experiment to a group of researchers. The criticality experiments were crude, even for their time, and known to be extremely dangerous. Enrico Fermi himself had warned Slotin would be dead within a year if he continued conducting these dangerous experiments. On that fateful day, Slotin's demonstration was as crude as it was reckless. Instead of using tungsten carbide bricks to reflect the neutrons back at the core and achieve criticality, a beryllium dome had been created which could be fitted over the core. Slotin began to lower the dome over the sphere, the neutrons fired off by the demon core bouncing back at it and feeding the nuclear chain reaction. Slotin knew that in order to prevent the mass from going critical, though, he would need to maintain just a small gap at the bottom and not lower the beryllium dome entirely. This would allow just enough neutrons to escape. Thus, Slotin used a screwdriver to prop up the dome from the bottom and ensure it would not cover the core completely. Scientist Raymer Schreiber turned from the experiment to see to other matters, ignoring what had become a routine demonstration by now. As he turned away from Slotin, though, the entire room was filled with a blue flash and a wave of heat. The screwdriver Slotin was using to prop up the beryllium dome had slipped, encasing the core completely and letting it go supercritical. Slotin immediately flipped the dome off, but just like Doglian before him, it was too late. Everyone in the room received a massive dose of radiation, but Slotin, being so close to the demon core, received a fatal dose. Slotin was rushed to the hospital where he went through bouts of nausea and vomiting and then seemed to recover. However, within days he began to lose weight and experienced severe abdominal pain. Slowly, he began exhibiting signs of mental confusion as his body literally began to break down from the inside out. To make matters worse, his insides had suffered what doctors called a three-dimensional sunburn, as the flash of radiation severely burned Slotin's body, in parts down to the bone. 9 days later, Slotin was dead, the second victim of the demon core. New procedures were immediately implemented to halt the reckless hands-on criticality experiments, and new rules forced scientists to use remotely controlled machinery from a distance of hundreds of meters. The demon core, which was initially slated to be used in Operation Crossroads, the nuclear test set to begin a month later at Bikini Atoll, was instead melted down and reintegrated into the U.S. nuclear stockpile. Built for massive destruction, the demon core was once more cheated its ultimate destiny, but it had already gotten its revenge in the deaths of two brilliant scientists. Why do you think scientists didn't take better safety measures after Doglian's death? Let us know in the comments, and as always, if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more great content.